Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sacred Scars, resting in God's promise that your past is not wasted, by Dr. Michelle Bengtson. Narrated by Susan Hanfield. Introduction. Pain. There is pain all around us. If we aren't experiencing physical, emotional, relational, or spiritual pain now, either we recently have, we likely soon will, or we are walking alongside someone in the trenches who wonders if they will survive. For many, this world is a treacherous place, and pain and sorrow seem daily on the horizon. There is no escaping the pain of this life until God calls us home. But there is hope in the waiting. There are lessons to be gleaned from the wilderness. There are promises we've been given as a lifeline when no one else can offer assurances. Friend, I don't know what variety of pain you're walking through or have recently survived, but I want you to know you're not alone, and God doesn't waste our pain. Time and distance may make sharing over coffee together an impossibility, but you're in my thoughts, in my heart, and in my prayers as I type these words. I want you to know you will get through this. Of that I'm certain. How can I be so certain, you ask? Have you not so far survived every single difficult circumstance in your life 100% of the time? You have. You're here now. Those trials may not have turned out exactly as you'd hoped, and you may have made a few mistakes along the way. We're all flawed, and that's okay. You may have the bumps, bruises, and scars in the form of loss, grief, shame, guilt, or regret to show for the battles you fought. But that means you survived. If we were sitting on my patio together, watching the cows graze next door, me with my coffee in hand, and you with your beverage of choice, I'd hope that you would share about your battle wounds and scars. Each one tells an important story and helps create the narrative of who you are. And each one is sacred. God doesn't treat your scars lightly, nor does he ignore their impact on your life. He doesn't just use your scars as a tool. God shapes your scars and shapes you in the process. You are braver, stronger, more tenacious, more resilient, and more beautiful for them. Your scars are valuable, as are the stories they tell. Your scars may not be physical scars that can be seen by the eye, but may be emotional scars, relationship scars, grief-borne scars, or even spiritual scars. Scars that can be perceived and understood only through the wisdom and experience of a fellow sufferer. And some scars may be known only by God. Friend, I don't know the pain you've endured or the scars you now carry, but I have found that, much like soldiers on the front lines of war, we can endure much more when we know we aren't in the muck alone. When we're in a painful battle, we wonder, will I make it through this? How will this change my life? And is there purpose in my pain? Loneliness often accompanies the crucible of pain. And we long to know we aren't alone in our suffering, and that someone else understands. It's then that the stories of others who have walked similar paths have the potential to most encourage our hearts. And once we've come through the furnace of suffering, we can share our stories with others who feel the way we once did. Sometimes our stories encourage others to stay the course. Many times, stories inform and give hard-earned wisdom to someone just a few rungs down on the ladder of their own journey. Often, they inspire us to reach beyond what we thought we were capable of. Occasionally, they redirect the course of our future. But they always serve a purpose and impact us if we'll let them. Because God never wastes our pain. I pray that throughout this book, you will take my hand to hold and hear my heart. You are not alone in the battle. I hope each of the stories and the sacred scars they represent offer you strands of hope that you can weave into a lifeline when your own hope wanes. These are real people who have fought real battles and have the scars to prove it. Let their stories encourage you, inform you, teach you, motivate you, and comfort you. Just like in my other books, I've provided a recommended playlist of songs to encourage you on your healing journey. The entire playlist can be found at drmichellebengtson.com/resources/playlists. I've also given you a scarred perspective, a biblical promise to hold on to until your wounds are fully healed and your sacred scars formed. Growth and healing often take place within community, and sometimes we don't see our potential or recognize God's hand at work in our lives until others bring it to our attention. Once we've finished our coffee and you've shared about your scars, and I've affirmed you with a few of my own, I would offer to pray for you. Not because there is anything special or powerful about my prayers, but because all power exists from the one who answers. In lifting you to his ear and his heart, I leave you in the best hands possible. Because even when our time together comes to an end, he will never leave you. And his healing continues. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Psalm 147, verse 3. Father, I lift up the one listening to this book. They have sacred scars that only you may know. But the pages of their story, tear-stained as they may be, have woven a narrative that makes them beautifully and uniquely them. Would you encourage their heart to know that you hold not only their tears in your bottle, but their scars in your heart as precious, sacred offerings on this screenplay of life for which you have cast them? Help them to see your hand in and through their sacred scars, and to know you better for it. Extend your hand, steady their feet, and walk them through their pain and through the stories their scars tell, to come to the place where they know you never waste their pain. In Jesus' name, amen. Friend, your pain, your wounds, and your scars are in good hands. admiring your scars from afar. Dr. Michelle. 1. The stories our scars tell. They triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. Several years ago, a television advertisement featured two old men in swimsuits at a public pool. Instead of getting after their exercise, they stood on the edge of the pool comparing scars in a humorous attempt to one-up each other by pointing out the physical reminders of accidents and surgical experiences. These were boastworthy scars worn with pride. Similarly, you might recall classmates who showed up to elementary school with a bright white plaster cast on an arm or a leg. As traumatic as the precipitating event may have been, other classmates quickly surrounded the cast bearer, seeking the details and desiring a chance to add their initials, graffiti, and well wishes to the cast with colorful felt-tip pens. Some of the cast wearers carried their own favorite colored felt tips. The pain and trauma were clearly diminished by the increased attention and social status the cast conferred. Those scars became social magnets. One of our sons recently made a foray into the world of snowboarding. Thankfully, he donned a helmet for the endeavor. He basically had little choice, or he knew one day his neuropsychologist mother would find out and give him what for, before taking a tumble down a hill that left him with a gash, which is now turned into an endearing memorial scar. The events that precipitated that scar were rather humbling, so he has taken to regaling friends and family with ever-changing tales that grow more grandiose and outlandish with each passing year. Recently, a young quarterback on a professional football team was asked at a post-game press conference how he handles the comments of those who question his abilities. His response was, "I carry my scars everywhere I go. I don't forget." Very few of us forget the circumstances that precipitated our scars. He added that he's moved on and that he doesn't waste his energy worrying about someone else's opinion and prefers to focus on improving his performance. On the other side, how is it that these artifacts that we universally associate with trauma, pain, and loss come to carry pride, social status, or motivation? Is it the passage of time? The approval of others? Some shift in perspective? What kind of commentary would we hear from these individuals if we could rewind the clock to the moment of the trauma or error, illness or disease, accident, public humiliation? I don't think any of us would speak with confidence or humor in those moments. These are the events that take time to heal from. At the time, those in the previous examples would have had a vastly different effect, certainly lacking the humor, social engagement, and confident calmness that mark their anecdotes. These events likely initially elicited frustration, confusion, anger, embarrassment, despair, fear, shock, or grief. In a moment, or in time, pain would come, physical, emotional, social, or spiritual pain, or the pain of guilt, shame, regret, or loss. Yet these examples are of individuals who have clearly survived the event. They are, to some degree, on the other side, with sacred scars to show for it. Their journeys and the personal changes wrought are interesting to us. Why? Because we know that their journeys were difficult and required the personal courage of facing adversity and persevering. To some degree, in our own pain, we want the encouragement that if they made it through, maybe we can too. It is archetypal to view an individual who has persevered as a hero, a survivor, or an overcomer. We view them as strong, confident, and capable, thinking, if they could handle that, is there anything they can't handle? Or, I wish I had the courage, confidence, compassion, or understanding they display. Or, if only I could gain the capability, outcome, or result they've achieved. Hollywood knows this. It's the basis for most movies. A sympathetic hero facing an unexpected and undeserved but daunting challenge. Inevitably, we are on the edge of our seats, pulling for the good guy to triumph. It's also something most marketers know. Think about the numerous advertisements where some beautiful actor describes massive weight loss or the development of large and obvious muscles. They generally claim that with product X and a few short weeks, you can look like this, with the implicit understanding that losing the flab or developing cinema-worthy abs will deliver the confidence we lack or the status we crave. These pitches are usually delivered with a focus on the bright, shiny product and not the sweat, pain, and suffering that go with it to achieve the results portrayed. We see ourselves in those stories, in those advertisements, and even in the funny commercials, like the one with the two old men. In some way, they describe us, because even if the precipitating circumstances are different, pain is universal. We know that life is challenging. It comes with suffering and adversity, and we can see them displayed in the stories we hear and in the lives of those around us. We like to hope that we would respond positively in similar circumstances. But we wonder. We wonder if we have the right stuff to get through it. Even if we can't describe the right stuff or explain what get through it means. So we look for heroes, people who've been there, who've survived, or come out the other side. Seeing the triumph of others, even in fictional accounts, assures us that it can be done. It gives us narratives in which we can vicariously see ourselves winning or overcoming. Changed somehow. But what of the suffering, or sweat, or work that comes with the stories those scars tell? We know it isn't all glory and honor. We don't cheer for the person lying on the couch, eating chocolate, and binge-watching Netflix. We cheer for Rocky, the guy who is struggling, who's trying, who's persevering despite the pain. Even in the losing, we see the value of the effort, of the valiance, of the wholehearted engagement. But we have an approach avoidance perspective to the sufferings and scars of life. We admire those who come through, but we don't want to personally suffer the circumstances. We admire the outcomes, the understanding, courage, conviction, or confidence. But we'd much rather take a pill to achieve them, instead of putting in hard, focused, continuing work. Or worse, personal suffering and pain. In hearing these stories, we know that the people involved were changed somehow. They have scars to show a change, physical, emotional, mental, relational, spiritual, or otherwise. We can see it in their words, actions, or attitudes, a fearlessness toward new situations, or a sensitivity to others, or wisdom, or appropriate caution replacing recklessness. Even without knowing a person deeply, it's still possible to see changes in their perspectives, priorities, or passions after they come out of a traumatic or aversive event. We can tell that they think differently about themselves, others, or the world around them. We like to provide attribution to these changes. It's human to tag victory over a tragedy or circumstance as triumph of the human spirit, or as a protagonist finding their place in life, or coming to terms with reality. It feels good to put a frame around something that is discomforting, that is maybe a little scary or dangerous to us, and that we don't fully understand. Is this really just an abstract projection, though? Is it believing in Hollywood, or wanting to find something redeeming or virtuous in suffering? It lets us compartmentalize a fearful thing. But is it honest? Are we just voyeurs armchairing another's tragedy and imputing glorious motives to make ourselves feel better about the fates of life? Do we think that if we can describe them, then they won't be so scary? And maybe, just maybe, we will be less likely to fall under their sway. Better, I think, to skip the attribution and to leave the armchair vacant. Better to ask the person in the arena. It is his story and his to feel the fear, loss, shame, guilt, or even victory. It is hers to bear the scars and to live the scarred life with sacred reverence. It is his to reap the benefits and blessings of the courage or compassion or conviction that may come from the suffering and scars. And hers to describe the rhythm and cadence of her daily walk during and after the fact. We know that pain, suffering, and hardship fall into everyone's lives, whether we bring them upon ourselves or not. These experiences, physical, emotional, relational, or spiritual, often slash our esteem and confidence, kick at our resolve, and damage our own sense of identity and value. Painful trials often ignite or reignite regret, shame, fear, guilt, condemnation, or sense of loss, and lead to scarring, permanent marks of imperfection, either physical external scars or hidden internal scars known only to us and God. We perceive these scars as ugly, as marring something that once had value and displayed beauty, but no longer does. Like a cracked vase, a broken frame, or a scratched tabletop. We come to believe that the wounds and brokenness of our dirty, messy lives and their resulting scars disqualify us from living a full and complete life, that they leave us marred and ugly, beautyless and valueless in the sight of others and of God, like a chipped plate no longer safe to eat from. As a board-certified clinical neuropsychologist, I've been given the honor and privilege of walking with my patients through their pain, hearing their most intimate stories, some they've never shared with anyone else, and witnessing their sacred scars. I've heard the stories of many people who confess to believing that their past pain, mistakes, sins, and wounds, and the resulting emotional, physical, relational, or spiritual scars made them less lovable, less qualified, or less valued in their own estimation or in the sight of others and of God. A platform of preparation. Although we fear the events that scar us and we view scars negatively, they are often the platform of preparation God uses to draw us to Himself, to show us who we really are, to highlight new facets of His character for us to experience, and to powerfully demonstrate the preciousness with which He holds us, a preciousness that goes beyond human understanding. Through these transformations, God trains us for the plans and purposes He defined for us before we were born. Plans and purposes to know and live this incredible worth with which He esteems us, and to share it unashamedly and compassionately with other wounded and broken people. Have you grown weary? Have you played by the rules, taken the high road, sacrificed, prayed, believed, hoped, and worked, but still feel like resolution eludes you? Maybe you know joy comes in the morning, but your night has grown dark and long, and it hasn't felt like morning in a long time. I don't know why your season has prevailed so long, but I do know this. There is purpose in our pain. I know of no one I deeply admire or respect who hasn't walked through dark and difficult days. Those I know who are called upon to do great things and fulfill great destiny walk through fire and flood and famine first. Take heart. You are not alone. Let this trial have its perfect work in you, as the testing of your faith produces endurance, and the heat and pressure form your lump of coal character into a diamond of clarity and brilliance and beauty. I know you're tired. I know you are low on strength, and perhaps lower on morale. But don't give up. This is the prayer of my heart for you. So let me pray for you now. God, strengthen this weary soul. Show them just a glimpse of heaven's perspective, like when you look down upon your servant Job. Bear them up. Cause them to feel your presence, and allow your joy to become their strength. Breathe on them and help them to trust not only your sovereignty, but also your affection and concern and care. Let them hear your voice, whether in the pit or prison or palace, and know that you are God Almighty, their glory and the lifter of their head. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't allow this trial to push you past your hope or cause you to stop pursuing your dreams. Lean into it. Push with the pain, like a woman in labor. Use it to birth your future. See the joy set before you and take courage to stand another day. My story is one that is filled with hurt, mistakes, regrets, broken pieces, ugly truths, and shards of pain I would prefer to keep locked in a box. And yet, each morning, God gives me breath and reminds me that my story is also filled with grace that pulled me out of the pit of despair, unexpected healing and recovery, peace that made no sense, a declaration of value and identity, and a deeper relationship with my Heavenly Father. This is the Father who sustains me and gives me the strength to persevere when the tenuous and weaker side of me is tempted to wave the white flag of surrender and give up. My friend, God doesn't play favorites. He loves each one of his children completely, unconditionally, and intimately. When Christ died on the cross, he did so for each one of us. What God has done to bring beauty from the ashes of my pain and the pain of others who share their stories in the following sections, he longs to do for you as well. Through the stories of others, ancient and contemporary, we will explore how pain and suffering inflict wounds, then become scars, but then reveal a treasure of transformation, redemption, and purpose. Many have been scarred by life's thorny path and now have an identifiable mark to show how God comforted them and brought them to a level place where the beauty of their scars is now greater than their pain. In the coming sections, you will hear stories of persevering and overcoming, and of finding encouragement in community, but mostly of the faithfulness and presence of a personal God, of his revelation to each storyteller of true beauty, value, and identity made visible through their sacred scars. The pain points of today, the battle wounds you continue to fight, those that remain tender to the touch, if not a bit bruised in your heart, will heal in time. The scars of your previous life scuffles no longer represent open wounds, but symbolize a roadmap of the healing God has provided, even if it's still unfinished, and testify to his unchanging character. It is my hope that as you learn to honor your scars as sacred to God, you will begin to appreciate just how far you've come, so that on the painful days, your heart will be encouraged to stay the course. My prayer is that you will come to know how beautiful God thinks you are, and that you will give him your guilt, shame, and regret over the things that caused you pain. I pray that you would see the incredible value he places on you and recognize the identity in him that he offers, and that you would allow him to redeem your suffering as he heals your wounds and seals your sacred scars. Your pain and your scars are precious to God as an offering of your life for him to mold and shape in the process. Sometimes, seeing the purpose in the pain of others helps us identify God's redemption in our own stories. I pray that you will be blessed by the stories of others' sacred scars in the coming sections. A scarred perspective. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, New Living Translation. My prayer for you. Father, this precious child of yours has gone through the crucible of pain, Help them to trust you in the waiting, as you heal their wounds and bring beauty from their ashes in the form of sacred scars. Assure them that you never waste their pain, and you bring purpose from their past into their future. We look to you not just for healing, but also for redemption of that which was lost, stolen, or broken. In Jesus' name, amen.
2. Scars signify a battle. You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 45. When you look back over the landscape of your life, are there deep wounds you keep hidden from the rest of the world? What do you cover up so others won't see? What negative experiences have you gone through, or mistakes have you made, that you believe disqualify you from something greater in your future, because you don't have things all together? Are there physical, emotional, relational, or spiritual hurts, wounds, pains, disgraces, or traumas that have significantly and negatively impacted the lens through which you view your life? Just weeks after I turned in the manuscript for my book, Breaking Anxiety's Grip, my husband and I were driving to an appointment when my cell phone rang. On the other end was my doctor, who had run some tests only days before. Upon answering, I heard the words no one expects, nor wants to hear. I hate to have to tell you this, Dr. Bengtson, but you have cancer. I have no idea what she said next. I was already reacting. What? That can't be. I'm healthy. I exercise daily. I eat well. As long as you consider an occasional piece of chocolate at least good for the soul, if not good for the body. They must have the wrong patient. Dr. Bengtson, are you there? What? I mean, yes. Sorry, I was just processing what you said. I understand. We need to schedule you for surgery right away. Would you like to schedule that now? I'm sure what proceeded to pour from my lips sounded more like a stutter or stammer than intelligible words. No.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.